So thank you so much for joining us, Will. It's an absolute pleasure to have you here.
Not at all. Thank you so much. It's great to be here. Can everyone hear me all right? Is that... Yeah? Okay, cool.
Good.
No one was going to say no, but good.
So I thought I'd just jump straight in and kind of start with a... I think I've noticed about your career, you started off doing kind of comedy films and big blockbuster CGI films, but now you seem to be moving into more socially commentary and poignant films. Is that a conscious choice that you've made?
Yeah, I suppose where possible, where I can kind of exercise some control over that, I try. Very fortunate, and you know, I should preface all of this by saying that I got very, very lucky. The first job I ever did was an independent film called Son of Rambo. We made it for about £4.50 in 8 weeks during a summer holiday when I was 12 years old. And, you know, I didn't know what was gonna happen. I loved drama at school. I was terrible at everything. And drama was really the only thing that I liked. So I was kind of, you know, at 12 years old, I was betting the farm on that because I knew I didn't really have anything else going for me. When that kind of, that film kind of superseded anyone's expectations and ended up kind of going worldwide and all that, I was totally unprepared for it. But it did give me some hope as far as, you know, what I might do after school and whatnot. Yeah, from there, I went on to do some slightly more bigger budget kind of CGI things. And I think of late, I've just been trying to make sure that I'm paying close attention to the messages that are attached to the projects I'm involved in, you know. It's not lost on me that as an actor, I do quite a self-obsessed job. And, you know, I think I've just been trying to think about the social application of my work a little bit more, where I can do good and hopefully provide more than just a little bit of entertainment where possible. And certain experiences along the way have sort of reaffirmed that desire to find socially responsible projects and think carefully about the message.
Then as you've kind of had to deal with celebrity and fame, do you feel a sense of duty to kind of speak up and be a voice for those matters that are important to you and those kind of socially relevant things?
Yeah, I think so. You know, I think I'm in a very fortunate, privileged position and I have a platform that I want to be able to use for good wherever possible. I do feel a sense of responsibility or moreover, I feel like it would be irresponsible to kind of not utilize it and take full advantage of that, you know, wherever possible, really. But yeah, you know, being realistic, I'm an actor, I'm not, you know, saving lives for a living. So there's only so much my work can do and potentially any ambitions I have, you know, in the name of activism or social action, I'll do separately. But where the two can intersect, you know, I'll always try and find that point of intersection. A really kind of awakening experience for me was doing a film called Detroit, which was based on the rebellion in 1967 in Detroit after sort of race relations in America, but Detroit specifically kind of reached boiling point and people of color in Detroit were kind of left with no option but to rebel. It's often referred to as a riot, but that's wrong in many ways because it's suggestive of sort of unprovoked anger and violence, whereas that wasn't the case. And being a part of that story and being kind of re-educated on my privilege, on race, on a lot of the history that is sort of conveniently and quite oddly edited out of our curriculum. I think, and I don't want to speak for America, but you know, at least in the UK, I found myself at 25 years old learning things about, you know, very, very important fundamental things about the history I guess personal history, because it's all personal, but things that I should have learned at school at 25 years old, and like it was a like light switching on. I was like, wow, there's lots of stuff I don't know, and that certainly infused my work ethos with a desire to make things more kind of socially responsible.
So what kind of things were they that you learned?
I got to meet with a couple of experts on specifically African-American history. And over a number of weeks in the lead up to the film, kind of you know, shooting, and the rehearsal process was sort of infused with a lot of education. There was a lot of kind of classroom time, and I loved it. You know, it was really, really informative and potentially kind of more informative than a lot of the sort of classes I took at school, to be honest, on those topics. And I think that's just because there was no agenda other than to give us the facts. But I was sort of embarrassed that I didn't know them sooner.
I mean, you've spoken a lot recently about trying to deconstruct your privilege and kind of acknowledge your own privilege. Why do you think that's so important to do now?
I think because it's a complicated one, because obviously I can only really like speak for myself, but I went to a really nice London day school, and I was very lucky to go there, received a great education, for which my like family worked very hard to give me that, and I'm hugely grateful. But I think I was undereducated in a lot of kind of key areas. My privilege, unearned privilege, and the undeserved suffering of other people, you know, included. And that meant that I went into the world interacting with lots of different people without really knowing anything about what their experience might have been, and not really understanding just, you know, what my privilege had afforded me up until that point. And it's kind of scary to think that, like, future generations, without looking carefully at how we educate young people, might kind of make the same mistakes that, you know, I made or was, you know, liable to continue making. So I think it's important, because now more than ever, you know, in the face of divisiveness and borders going up and attempted wall building, we need compassion and we need empathy and we need understanding, you know, between people. I think as millennials, I think, like, roughly speaking, the definition of millennial, someone, you know, is a little hazy. There's probably one in the Oxford Dictionary, but millennials are often, we're kind of often laughed at, sneered at for being oversensitive, for being easily offended. And I'd sort of turn that on its head and say that one of the things I'm proud of, as far as my generation is concerned, or something that I think we can all take pride in as being identified as a millennial, is that that oversensitivity or that, you know, easily offended label could be turned on its head as just compassionate, as being more considerate than previous generations. And I think that's arguably a hallmark of the millennial, is our compassion and our desire to develop empathy for other people's experiences. That will carry us in good stead moving forward, and we need that. I think there's actually been a lack of sensitivity and consideration for the experience of other people in previous generations.
And you've spoken a lot recently again about the importance of art and drama in schools to teach young people this kind of emotional empathy. How important was it for you to have that experience?
Massive, only because my grades were so terrible that, like, I needed something to do. I had to contribute somehow. But I think also supporting, you know, people and young people in the educational systems, however, you know, that may be framed, across the board, not just in the kind of traditional sense, you know, not just in your maths, your Englishes and your sciences, which are all obviously very important, But nurturing people's, you know, innate talents and interests, whether it be in the arts, whether it be maybe in subjects that we don't even necessarily teach. Like, this is a little bit far-fetched, and I don't have the brain to be able to kind of put a plan together or rewrite the syllabus. But, you know, there's physical education, but I find it shocking that there's so little attention paid to mental health as part of the educational process. I find that odd. I never really received any information about how to maintain a good state of mental health, and I think that might be partly why a stigma exists around mental health, because you don't talk about it for such a long time, or at least it's in the shadows of conversation. I think that's something that millennials are actually responsible for tackling. I think that's something that we've done a good job of addressing. But I think school needs to sort of yeah, or at least the schooling system needs to kind of embrace that somehow. And going back to history, you know, I think a lot of the things I learned in my history classes are just totally inadequate. I just learned a lot of mistruths about history, particularly Britain. I mean, we didn't make a great deal of friends for quite a long period of time, and I feel like what I learned of British history was that it was all entirely positive and wonderful, and we were nothing but a great influence on the world. Yeah, it wasn't until after school I did my own research that I found out the truth about that. So there's just a few things that, looking back on my school career, I feel like could have been improved upon. And I, speaking to other young people who are still in school, I hear them kind of learning the same things, and that's a bit disheartening.
So then, you spoke about mental health when Bandersnatch released. You withdrew from Twitter, saying that you had, you know, it was tough for your mental health to deal with all that came with that. Tell us a little bit about what happened following Bandersnatch's release.
Yeah. For anyone who didn't see, I did a thing called Bandersnatch. It's on Netflix, and it's kind of this weird interactive film come game. It's part of the Black Mirror series, and I was really, really lucky to do it. Very grateful. And there was quite a lot of chatter regarding Bandersnatch and various things about the program in and around the time of its release. My decision to leave social media at that point was actually totally unrelated to any of the creative-led conversations about Bandersnatch or what it was like as a piece of art or whatever. There were some other conversations unrelated to anything creative that were going on at the same time that I was the sort of subject of, that it wasn't beneficial for me to just be witness to it. I kind of feel like I don't seek the opinion of thousands of people that I don't know in my everyday life. So why was it that I found myself scrolling through the opinions of lots of people, you know, on things about me that, it was strange. So I felt like the best thing to do was distance myself from that, step away. And you know, you can't control what people say online, you know, and you can't expect people to behave in a certain way. I think all you can do is kind of, you know, recognize when there's danger and relinquish some control by stepping away when necessary. So just the interest of my mental health, I did that. And the way I put it is, you know, if someone is excessively complimentary to me online, I don't carry over an inflated sense of myself into the real world because someone tweeted me something really nicely. I don't then walk to the shops thinking I'm amazing. And, you know, to the same extent, if someone says something incredibly nasty to me online, I should try not to, you know, have that affect my mental health and kind of deplete my mood, but it's hard. And social media is this sort of other dimension that I think we all have to consider in the context, in the grander context of our mental health ultimately. Like, is this actually good for me, you know? Because for the most part it might be, but you might be one of those people like me that realized the balance was off and actually it was mostly a negative experience, you know?
So you said that we're the millennial generation, the generation that's gone online, is a more sensitive generation. Why do you think there is so much vitriol on these social media platforms?
What do you mean by vitriol? Sorry, I've got limited vocabulary.
You know, abusive kind of language. And
It's weird, isn't it? I don't know. I mean, that's not to say there isn't a lot of good and, you know, the social mobility afforded by social media has, you know, meant that people can reach out from far corners of the world and interact and understand each other better and send each other complimentary messages and get together and do wonderful things. That is happening, I'm sure. But it's odd that there seems to be such a kind of collective lean towards trolling and cyberbullying and just general nastiness. And I think that's because of the disconnect that's afforded by the keyboard. I think that keyboard warrior thing is very real. And that was something that I reminded myself of. I thought a lot of the negative things that people were saying about me online, they possibly wouldn't say to my face. And I had to kind of, I think adopt that attitude towards it. I think that's only fair to say that, because I don't think people are that nasty to themselves. day to day, but then you've got to ask yourself, why are you doing it at all? You know, be it through your online avatar or not, why are you going out of your way to say something nasty to someone ultimately you've never met and you don't know? It's weird. I don't know what it is. I don't know whether it's just a vacuum where people are able to kind of shout their frustrations or vent. But it's odd. And I just think, yeah, it's important that people, as much as anything else, call out, you know, bullying, harassment, whatever form or shape it takes, online and offline.
Then you've spoken a lot previously about your experiences with bullying, especially at school. Do you see yourself moving into a more vocal advocacy role against anti-bullying, especially going to schools in the future?
Yeah, I mean, that's another thing that I'm like a wannabe minister for education. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about, to be honest. But yeah, I've been involved with an anti-bullying charity since 2010. And they do amazing works where they go into schools and they work with young people to train up anti-bullying ambassadors who then implement different sort of programs into kind of everyday school life to monitor bullying and generally just make schools a safer, happier, and ultimately more kind of productive environment. And that again is so bizarre. I think too many schools, too many educational institutions, facilities, whatever, I think they have a very old school, traditional, archaic attitude towards bullying, whereas it's part of character building, or it's just part of growing up, or it makes you stronger. It's that kind of stiff upper lip attitude that actually, down the line, doesn't really help anyone out, leads to mental health issues. I think the scars of bullying, you know, are kind of, can last a long, long time after you've left school. I experienced some bullying at school, but not nearly as bad as a lot of the bullying that I witnessed. And I worked with a teacher at school to try and implement a kind of anti-bullying program, which was kind of semi-embraced, but it was also looked at like a little bit soft, you know, and not quite taken seriously. And I just find it odd. I think what's great about Anti-Bullying Pro, which is in association with the Diana Award, they're up and down the country now and expanding internationally. And hundreds and hundreds of schools have fully embraced the anti-bullying programs and they've benefited from it. Bullying rates are reduced massively. The kids are generally far more happy and it's in the school's interest, I think, to create that kind of environment because it gets the best out of young people. You want to go to school, you know, feeling safe and happy as a young person, not, you know, dreading the fact that you might be bullied in the hallways or feeling like, you know, you have to endure a really inhospitable environment just to be able to, you know, get your grades or you know, approach your work passionately. I wasn't that passionate about school, but you know what I mean? Some people are.
Then I want to take a leap now and talk about actually a couple of your roles. Starting with The Revenant, how brutal was that process?
Oh my gosh. Well, first of all, like, I'm so lucky, again, you know, hesitant to complain. I was working with some pretty amazing people and, you know, I would have happily held the mop in the background. I was just really, really genuinely ecstatic and kind of in disbelief to be there. But it was, if I may say, so brutal and easily the hardest thing I've ever done. And I'd be shocked if I do anything harder, like physically. It was 7 months in crazy, crazy cold I didn't know existed. And yeah, I can remember, like, there's a couple of things that like are burned into my memory or frozen into my memory. But there was one day on set where the camera froze because it was so cold. And it was in the minus 30s. It was freezing. And everyone who had facial hair, which was every male except me, was just wearing beards of ice and snow. And if you breathed in your, I don't know if this is a sort of scientific word, but your bogies, if you know what I'm talking about, would freeze. It was like having a nose full of gravel anytime you like breathed in. So you just tried not to breathe in as much as possible. It was so cold and brutal, but the director, Alejandro González Iñárritu, is a visionary, someone I've loved, watched Babel and Beautiful. He's just an incredible director. And he just has an unflinching, unwavering desire to get what he wants and get something as close to perfection as possible. And if that means scaling a mountain in minus 30, you know, 20 times over, like that's you know, that's what he's prepared to do. The crew was so, so talented, and I got to work with some of my heroes in the acting department. So I was very, very lucky.
Were there any moments during the filming where you just stopped and thought, what am I doing?
Oh, every day. yeah. Most days, to be honest. It was really surreal, a lot of that. But yeah, very, very grateful for the opportunity.
Did you find it daunting working with such great directors and actors, or is it something that you relish opportunity to get out there and do?
Yeah, I absolutely do. I think, you know, I've always tried not to kind of make any choices or discriminate according to genre, or, you know, certainly not names or budget or, you know, anything like that. I've always tried to make it about script and character. But naturally, I was incredibly excited to work with DiCaprio and Tom Hardy, and in this instance, Alejandro, the director, and Chivo, Emmanuel Lubietzky, who's the cinematographer, who I'm a big fan of too. And then, you know, yeah, there have been certain directors that I've always kind of wanted to work with, and it's just so happened. I've been lucky enough that it's you know, come to be sooner than I expected. Catherine Bigelow's one of my favorite directors ever, and you know, I got to work with her on Detroit, and as I say, that was just an all-round, incredibly enlightening, educational experience. And I think, yeah, again, now more so than ever, I'm trying to make sure that, yes, I have a great time and I develop as an actor, and I make sure that creatively I'm happy with it, but that the sort of, yeah, broader experience is a positive one, and its social application is something that I can, you know, comfortably stand behind.
So you talk about developing as an actor. A lot of the roles you do are often so different from ones you've done beforehand. Mm. Is that an intention to simply try and avoid a typecast, or do you feel as though you need to creatively expand each time to do something new?
Yeah. In some ways, I think I personally enjoy the challenge of playing away from home, so to speak, and trying to do something different from the last thing I did. I just hope that'll make it interesting for audiences. It makes it interesting for me, so sort of selfishly. I guess, you know, you do one thing and then sometimes you're in danger of, it's just a sort of like, it's like a very simple bounce back reaction from the industry if you play. When I did We're the Millers, which was a kind of fairly kind of bawdy comedy, and I played a sort of quote geeky kid, which, you know, according to the social stereotypes of what makes someone geeky, I arrived geeky. There wasn't much kind of characterization needed. I actually remember showing the costume department like me at school, and they were like, "Oh, we're just going to dress you like that." I was like, "Cool." I was like, "That's fine. I've still got the clothes. It might be a bit tight, but go for it." But I remember after that, you know, every role that came through, every audition that came through was the quote unquote geeky kid. And it was like, okay, but I kind of felt like I had to find something different to prove that I could maybe do something else. Because I think sort of typecasting kind of is something that the kind of industry does to you more often than the actor does to themselves. But then again, I'm a straight white middle class male, so I can't complain about, you know, the lack of roles available to me, obviously. And it's been encouraging to see how now the industry is turning its hand finally to, you know, some things that obviously should have been addressed a long, long time ago as far as diversity and representation is concerned.
Well, I think that's a great point to chuck questions out open to the audience. Mm. So if you'd like to put your hands up and wait for the microphone to be brought to you, and if you stand up when it does, yeah, let's go to the hand over in the corner first.
Perfect. Thank you so much for coming here tonight. I was wondering, both as part of a generation who's trying to become more socially conscious and talk about issues such as mental health more in media, and then also as an actor who's trying to engage in these projects, what do you think is the role and responsibility of TV and movies these days? Because you have, for example, 13 Reasons Why coming up, which is a bit contested, and stuff like BoJack Horseman. Do you think there's a way in which these TV shows have a heavier responsibility, and how do you think that can be done right?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Admittedly, I haven't seen 13 Reasons Why, but I heard about some of the controversy surrounding it, and I think it's vitally important. I think, you know, I'm not in any way doing down, you know, unapologetically blockbuster, popcorny, box office smashes, because historically speaking, in the toughest of times, in the deepest economic depressions, cinema and entertainment at large, in lots of different kind of, you know, mediums, has been successful. And I think that points to a truth about the power of television and film and theatre, that, you know, people go to those mediums for escapism and in order to be uplifted when they do feel down. So I think, you know, even financially, it makes sense to have those sorts of films available to people, as much as it does kind of socially or from a psychological standpoint. I really hope to do something that is, you know, specifically focused on mental health. I'm kind of on the lookout for that, and it's encouraging to see how, you know, the conversations about mental health and the efforts to dismantle the stigma around, you know, discussing mental health is reflected in the industry. And I think that's the most important thing, that, you know, art always kind of reflects realities that are faced by people and by the people who will be ultimately, you know, receiving that art, will be consuming it. It's frustrating, because unless it makes financial sense, then, you know, the people, the powers that be and the people in control won't necessarily finance it. So it requires kind of, you know, careful construction and involves an army of people. But I'm certainly on the lookout for something like that. And I think, you know, even the biggest box office smashes that, you know, and the kind of quote unquote popcorn movies that might not seem to have social application can be infused with, you know, wholesome messages without losing a buck at the box office. I think sometimes, you know, people categorize things so much so that they think a Marvel movie can't have a really kind of, you know, socially responsible message attached, and that's just simply not true. You know, you look at films that socially are groundbreaking and financially groundbreaking, and they were made by, two of them were made by millennials last year. Crazy Rich Asians, I think, was the first time in 24 years that a Hollywood film has had an all-Asian cast, a Hollywood film, and it was unbelievable. It superseded expectations beyond anyone's wildest imagination, and made so much money, and I think was incredible. Black Panther is a classic example of a big budget Marvel popcorn movie that, you know, socially was inspiring. So there's no excuse for, you know, however big the movie is, there's no excuse for, you know, it not being socially applicable in the right ways. If that ramble answers your question at all.
Thank you.
Pavel, let's take another question. Let's jump to the hand on the left in the back.
My question's not so much about, you know, the health and things like that, but more on the acting side. I'm very curious, on movies like Maze Runner and things that are so graphically designed and so technologically advanced, how do you work in that sort of environment? Because we know most of the time it is a green screen sort of thing, so your imagination needs to be running absolutely wild. How do you work with the characters when, I mean, it could just be a person wrapped in bubble wrap, but I mean, how are you able to, like, transfer your mind from, okay, I'm looking at you next to me and you look like one thing, but I need to already be, my mind has been preconceived that this is what you're going to be. How does, like, the whole movie flow together and pretend and that? Mm.
It's a good question, because it's the kind of thing that I really did learn on the job. Really, you know, interacting with CGI elements, computer generated, what would become computer generated imagery, which at the time might just be kind of like a tennis ball on a stick, or as you say, someone wrapped in, you know, green nylon or something like that. It gave me a real kind of respect and understanding, or at least some understanding, for just how talented visual effects artists are. On the Maze Runner, it was interesting. For a movie of that kind of size and with the kind of ambition attached to it, it was actually a relatively small budget. The budget for that movie was probably comparable to like a rom-com budget or something like that. In this day and age, it's still a stupid amount of money, but just such as the way the film industry, you know, works, it was relatively modest. So we didn't necessarily have all the CGI that we wanted, but from an actor's perspective, that was quite nice because they actually physically built a lot of the elements. So the doors entering the maze, and for anyone who hasn't seen this film, this is going to make no sense, but the doors entering the maze were actually like built for us. And then we kind of had to imagine the sort of walls as green screen. It gets tougher when you do more intimate physical interactions with CGI characters. So I did one of the Narnia films, and I had a fight with a CGI mouse, and that was challenging. And I lost that fight. I actually lost the fight to the mouse. That was a sword fight with a CGI mouse on a boat at sea, and the boat wasn't actually at sea. So there, you know, 85, 90% of the performance is about the CGI and just about me trying to kind of stay in the frame with the mouse. Yeah.
Great, let's take another question. We'll go to the hand in the aisle on the back. You, sir.
What was it like working with DiCaprio on the set of The Revenant? And then do you think there's anyone you would like to work with in terms of kind of directors or actors as well?
Working with DiCaprio was amazing. I'd been a massive fan of his work and seen so many of his films. I think I'd seen Titanic about 100 times as a kid. That was like, I was obsessed with that movie. And seen him in a ton of other things, and he was naturally inspirational because he started so young and he's managed to craft this incredible career. And I think he's chosen so brilliantly over the years and done very few bad films, in my opinion. So I would have been absolutely crestfallen if he'd been a horrible person. I would have literally just, you know, gone home crying, I think, but he couldn't have been nicer to me. Really kind of put his arm around my shoulder, so to speak. And he's one of those actors that like is so good that you're almost scared into being the best version of yourself, if that makes sense. Like he just kind of forces you to be better than you actually are. So it's quite sad because I probably won't get to work with him again. He's amazing and incredibly encouraging and egoless. And he's also like I think the most inspiring, best and most talented people and the great leaders, wherever they kind of present themselves, not afraid to collaborate over every decision. Of course, take charge when necessary and you know, lead when they need to, but not afraid to hear every opinion in the room, not too proud to go back on an idea. And I remember the first time we were on set and he just turned to me and said, "What do you think?" And I didn't think he could possibly even want to hear what I thought about how we should do the scene, but that's how he is. That's how Catherine Bigelow is as well. You know, I think the best are like that. And in terms of people I'd like to work with in the future, oh my gosh, there's a big, big list. Actor-wise, I'd love to work with Meryl Streep. She's amazing. I'd love to work with Joaquin Phoenix. Director-wise, desperate to work with Barry Jenkins, Lynn Ramsey. Lynn Ramsey has a film called If You Were Never Really You Were Never Really Here, which came out this year. It was nominated for Outstanding British Film last night at the BAFTAs, and amazing Scottish director. That's with Joaquin Phoenix, which is great. Barry Jenkins has a film called If Beale Street Could Talk that came out 2 days ago, and he directed Moonlight. That's a few, but my list is embarrassingly, I'm a nerd, like film nerd, so my list is like this, but yeah, that's a couple.
Yeah, if you want to just pass the microphone, just the hand, just across from you.
Thanks for coming. You gave some really interesting answers that resonated, I think, with a lot of people in the audience, with me personally as well. But I'm going to move away from that and actually ask perhaps slightly a more trivial question. I belatedly watched We're the Millers for the first time on the weekend because I knew you were coming.
Oh my God, you did research. You're the swimmer.
Yeah. I prepared.
That's very kind.
Yeah. I've got notebooks and everything. For me personally, you, throughout the film, delivered what I thought was a near-perfect American accent, and I can't speak on behalf of all Americans, I don't know, I don't hear it on a daily basis, but I just wondered what kind of preparation work goes into that, and how difficult it is to maintain throughout kind of a filming period. Like, do you go into the kind of method acting phase and just speak with an American accent all day, and how does that work?
Right. That's very kind. I don't know whether it's perfect at all, but I'm sure it's not. But I'll be completely honest with you, and this is why it's a little bit weird. I think British actors are an unfair advantage when it comes to doing American accents in comparison to American actors doing British accents. I'm not saying that American actors aren't as good. I'm not saying that. But we're at an unfair advantage because we consume so much American media from a young age. I literally learned an American accent from watching Friends. And then I found myself on set with Rachel from Friends. I was like freaking out. So honestly, that was it. And you know, watching The Simpsons and Fresh Prince of Bel-Air and all of these things that, you know, we love in the UK, but come from America. They're so dominant in film and television. And we just, seem to ingest so much of it from so early on. So I've been doing impressions of American characters since I was a kid. And again, you got to understand, if I didn't make it clear, not good at school. So I just, all I had was trying to make people laugh and playing the clown. So I guess I practiced that way. The first time I experienced like staying in accent was I did a film in Ireland called Glassland, really small budget independent film with my friend Jack Rayner. And it's cool, you should see it just for Jack Rayner and Toni Collette. It's an amazing, like really beautiful mother and son relationship about battling addiction. Anyway, I did like I stayed in a Dublin accent for that for a week and probably offended a lot of Irish people along the way. I'll be honest with you, but you know, the Irish people I was working with were kind of, you know, permitted me that and allowed me to kind of do that around them, and it really helped. So that's something that I've employed with every job since. I'll kind of stay in the accent for fear of being looking like a complete wanker to the people I work with, because they're like, we know you're not from there, but. And my brother won't even talk to me on the phone when I'm working because he finds it too weird if I'm in an accent. So I don't talk to my brother with every job that I do. He just texts me. But yeah, staying in accent really helps. And my general thoughts on method acting is that sometimes people use method acting as an excuse to treat people they work with badly. So I'm not a massive fan of it. But I also would argue that everyone is a method actor because everyone has a method. It's kind of a weird buzz term, method acting. I think whatever helps you do the best job, so long as it's not at the expense of how you treat the people around you, and then it's all fair game. But you can't start punching people and say, sorry, I'm method acting, you know? So.
Let's jump to another hand. Yeah, let's go to the guy stood up by the door.
Thank you very much for coming again. Going over to Bandersnatch, you alluded to this question earlier, but do you see Bandersnatch as a TV show or more of a game? And following on from that, as someone who worked on the TV show game itself, do you see that kind of format going anywhere in the future? Or is it very much kind of like a one-off gimmick that Black Mirror was able to kind of use?
Yeah. It's interesting. It's comforting that Charlie Brooker, the creator of Bandersnatch and Black Mirror at large, with Annabelle Jones as the other kind of producer, co-creator, it's comforting to know that they were confused throughout the entire process. They found the complicated coding that went into Bandersnatch, which, as I mentioned before, was this kind of interactive TV show film come game that none of us really know how to describe. And it's also comforting to know that they haven't really settled on the terminology attached to experiencing Bandersnatch. They don't know whether you watch it or play it or experience it. So we've been kind of yeah, all kind of debating that through the press and promotional requirements that have come with its release. I think in the future there will be more interactive films and just, you know, pieces of media. I think that's just part of the natural kind of development. It's really cool to be one of the first. That also means that you might be the one that everyone looks back and go, imagine that was so shit, and now it's great. That's always a bit worrying, but yeah, it was very cool to be there, at least, you know, attempting the first one, but really hard too. I was kind of saying it in the like meet and greet upstairs with a few people. It was really, really mind-boggling at times, and it required so much mental energy, because, you know, one scene might have to be recorded, obviously from the usual 5 or 6, 7 different angles, but 5 times each time, if that makes sense, to account for all the different variations and all the different versions of that scene that the viewer might arrive at depending on the choices that they've made up until that point. So every scene comes with several sets of continuity to remember, different character histories, different character futures, and I was quite easily the worst in the entire cast at being able to kind of deal with all of that information. And I'd regularly break down and my head would feel like scrambled eggs, and the director had to be, you know, really patient with me, because TV, you move at such a pace as well. I haven't done that much TV, and yeah, you don't get that many like bites at the cherry. So it was tough. It was a challenge. But I think there will be more in the future. Not necessarily Black Mirror episodes, but there will be more, I'm sure.
Yeah. Brilliant. Let's jump to the hand just over here. Yeah, you, madam. Yeah.
Thank you for coming here. And as a part you talked earlier, you said like mental health is really important to you. So normally an actor, you can have a chance to play a different role. So of course it takes time to get into the role. So is it difficult? Is it you have ever experienced like you get into the role and you couldn't get out? And if like you couldn't get out, what you normally do to protect your mental health?
Sure. It's a really good question. I've always found, like, in a way, one of the ways with dealing with my, and this is probably not advisable, but one of the ways dealing with like my own insecurities and mental health struggles was I found kind of escapism in acting, and I've kind of borrowed identity from characters, if that makes sense. But it's kind of interesting how sometimes playing a character can, although offer you escapism initially, can actually begin to have an adverse effect on your mental health. Weirdly, like, we're the Millers, I got to be honest, maybe more than any of the characters I've ever played, that character, because I was playing like a battered, bullied, you know, socially repressed, kind of ultimately self-loathing character who was constantly being laughed at. By the end of the process, I was really like, I was weirdly and unexpectedly affected by that. So it's odd, like people will say, and particularly in the, you know, press, you'd sit opposite American journalists and be like, oh, it must have been so much fun. Like, you just had a ball, right? And you're like, actually, you can't say that. You can't say no. But I was thinking, no, like, not at all. I was pretty miserable through the entire experience. Really lucky to be there, still wanting to be there. But yeah, so when it comes to, yeah, trying to sort of combat that or avoid it, I don't know. I've found that I've paid special attention to looking after my mental health in between jobs, making sure that, you know, basic things like I'm getting enough sleep and I'm eating healthily. I started reading books literally at the age of like 25. I literally started about that late. But reading has been so beneficial for my mental health. I'm just gonna assume you all read quite a lot anyway, given the environment we're in. So I'm not gonna be like, you should try books. Really, I'm telling you, it's controversial, but you know that. I'm just saying what I've just learned. But yeah, reading's been amazing for me. And if anyone doesn't read Matt Haig yet, Matt Haig is an amazing writer on the subject of mental health. He's got a book called Reasons to Stay Alive, and he's got a book called Notes on a Nervous Planet, both amazing. yeah, physical exercise as well for my mental health as much as anything else. So just things like that, you know, in between jobs, pre and post, just to make sure I don't, yeah, sort of honestly like fall into a state of depression or something like that, you know?
Then let's jump across the app to the gentleman on the front row.
I just wanted to know, what are your top three favourite films of all time and why?
Oh, it's such a good question. Oh, I'm just so unprepared for it though, because I have about 300 favourite films. I couldn't rate them to three. For childhood nostalgia, Hook. I love Hook, obsessed with Hook. I'm also the biggest Robin Williams fan of all time. So that always gets a mention. This is horrible, I hate this already. That's really up there. There's a film called Short Term 12 that's not very well known. That's my sort of alternative indie choice. Which is, yeah, it's very good. Good Will Hunting's always been up there for me. It's one of those things that, like, objectively, a lot of people say, that's a good film. I do love that film. It's another Robin Williams movie. I would say those are three in my top 10, but I wouldn't necessarily say my top three, because I just couldn't do that. But those are three in my top 10. But yeah, if you haven't checked out Short Term 12, check that out, because you'll think I'm cool.
Yeah, let's jump to the hand. You met on the front row.
So a little while ago you said Where the Millers wasn't like the most fun experience, like making a film. Mm. Are there any films you've made which, I mean, you've actually enjoyed the experience thoroughly, or I don't know. Yeah.
Sorry, I know.
Or would you say that kind of making a film, it's kind of intrinsically a bit kind of draining or miserable, like you
yeah.
said?
Yeah, sorry, I know. I've just got up here and been like, yeah, it's really hard. And acting makes me sad. No, I here's the weird thing, here's the weird paradox. I find it emotionally draining. I find it really tough. I find it a huge challenge. I'm exhausted at the end of almost every day, but I'm absolutely obsessed with it and I love it. The Where the Millers experience in isolation was a little bit different. But there were still days that I absolutely loved and enjoyed. And yet, strangely, you know, there can be really, really dark subject matters and you can play really hateful characters, but ultimately you can still enjoy the experience and be excited about, you know, the development of the process as it continues. Detroit, you know, I played a racist police officer and there were days that were so, so tough and horrendous. And, you know, I mean, not even comparable to what the actors who were playing the kind of victims in that case were experiencing, but really, really tough. And yet that was one of the most rewarding, positive, kind of unifying experiences as far as being part of a cast I've ever kind of had. So absolutely, Glassland, which is, you know, very, very dark and about alcoholism and many other, you know, dark subject matters, but massively rewarding and yeah, hugely enjoyable. It's weird. Like I don't know if it makes any sense to say, but it's because this is gonna sound so pretentious, but acting, you know, it's impossible to completely become another person. And the fact that it is impossible is the thing that kind of keeps me on the hook, if that makes sense. Like I can keep chasing that, like a stupid dog chasing a rabbit forever, really happily. Mildly frustrated, but really happy and never stop. And like, that's kind of the way I see it. I'm a stupid dog, basically, is the sort of metaphor, yeah.
And yeah, can we jump to the hand just behind?
Talking of Bandersnatch, I have to ask, would you choose Frosties or Sugar Puffs?
It's a vital question. I think I chose Frosties. Yeah, I think I went with Frosties. And I was saying this again in the meet and greet just now, and I was like, really interesting data got released. I was like, it's like 51% to 49% Frosties and Sugar Puffs, like really even. And someone very astutely pointed out, they were like, do you think that's just because most people played it twice and it just kind of evened out? And I was like, oh, I'm at Oxford. I can't get away with comments like that. I was like,
yeah, I will be called out. That's true, that's probably what it is. It's not the most intelligent data out there, but yeah. But I chose Frosties.
Yeah, if we can go to the hand in the back row on the same side. Okay, you, madam.
Hi, yeah, thank you for coming. Kind of on a similar line, do you enjoy watching your own performances, watching your own films? And then maybe a deeper question piggybacking off of that, did you choose to have yourself jump first or the other person jump first off the apartment balcony?
Right. So the first one was, I don't enjoy watching my own stuff. I struggle with photographs, the moving image is terrifying. And I kind of feel like I have to watch stuff I'm in at least once or twice, literally just for the purpose of being able to talk about it vaguely confidently in press and in, you know, junkets, interviews, etc., etc. So I'll sometimes watch it with like friends and family at a premiere or something like that, you know, as a sort of means of kind of celebration, I guess. In fact, that's not true. That comes second. The first time I watch it with maybe someone I work with, it might be a cast and crew screening or literally just for kind of, you know, technical purposes, just so I know what to talk about in the press. Twice at most. I mean, three times makes my stomach turn a little bit. I can watch films that I'm not in so much three times. Like I could watch Glassland because I kind of pop up in it. I could watch Revenant because I'm in it, but I'm not like, you know, there's a lot more to unpack and watch and enjoy. And then segueing into your kind of, you know, the second part of your question, that was one of the nice things about Bandersnatch, is I was like, right, kill me and now I can enjoy this thing. I was like, no, let's see, you know, I quite enjoyed that. I think I threw myself off. And I also kind of knew, having read the script, that if I didn't, it would end more quickly. But I've watched it next to friends and family members, and it's a big thing. They're like, do you mind if I'm like, kill me already, come on, you know.
And then, let's jump to the hand just adjacent.
Hi, again, really interesting answers. I was just gonna ask about younger years. So obviously started really like quite young in the acting career and how that kind of was involved with the whole, you know, social media thing. Like when did that really take off for you and become so much of a problem, and also all of the other social aspects of that and, you know, being a child actor and growing up with that publicity?
I think really lucky in the sense that I had a school who were really supportive. They also obviously had a record of all my grades and they were like, no, it's probably best you go off and do something else. They allowed me to go off and shoot things, take time out of school. I moved to Australia for 6 months to shoot something when I was about 16, and my family like pretty much all came with me. So again, supportive school, supportive family. So very, very privileged in that respect. It meant I was able to kind of live a pretty normal existence, and really I didn't really start getting recognized until after I left university. I went to university for a year, just shy of a year. I went to Bristol briefly to do drama and really enjoyed it, but ended up leaving just for a job opportunity, and I kind of was doing some, you know, cost benefit analysis, and I was like, I'm just going to take this job, and I've had a great experience, but you know, I couldn't turn it down. The social effects have, I mean, not necessarily, I don't know, it's weird. All the kind of stuff that exists outside of the set and the work environments, however they present themselves, are not positive, I'll be honest. I hate being recognized, you know, but when you're 6'3" and you've got eyebrows like this, nothing you can do about it. It's gonna happen. And it's weird, I'm sort of recognized a disproportionately, you know, high amount given the amount of work I've done or how little the short amount of time I've been in the industry. You know, I can walk next to far more famous, far more talented people, and they'll be like, oh, you're the kid that has got bitten on the balls. And I'm like, yeah, that's it's me. You know, it's that sort of thing. And then, yeah, social media has only really become a thing. Yeah, I mean, since I was like a teen, and I don't know, it's weird. I, you know, another thing I'll say is I'm not totally off social media in the sense that I plan to go back and I want to use that extension of my platform in order to kind of talk about certain things and if there are causes and organizations that I work with who can benefit from that exposure, I'll continue to give them that where necessary and when they ask for it, and I intend to do that. But there's a lot of negative stuff attached to the sort of thing you're talking about, I think, that I just was best I removed myself from, basically.
And then let's jump to the hand in the very back row.
Hi. Just a more fun question.
Let's do out it. Of, I've just cracked open a fizzy water. Let's get crazy.
Out of all the accents that you've done, what was the most difficult accent to do, and could you give us a sample of it?
Oh my gosh. Basically, a sample of my worst accent, basically. There are a few of those. I don't know. The most challenging one was The Revenant, only because it was set so many years ago, and it was like 1852, and there are no recordings of that. And it was kind of guesswork, you know, as far as what someone in that, existing at that time in that particular location would sound like. If I remember correctly, it was Southeast Virginia, 1852. I played a character called Jim Bridger, who was kind of like a famous mountain man. So unfortunately, I couldn't kind of make it up. It had to be, you know, roughly right, because there are people from that region who at least know tales of Jim Bridger and probably have a good idea of what he sounded like. It's strange. It was kind of, it was sort of like, you know, take your standard accent from somewhere in the South America, say like Texas, just speaking very broadly, and then it was textured with a bit more English, you know, tones than you might normally have, and it was, almost closer to my own voice than maybe, you know, a typical kind of like Southern accent might sound like. So it was strange, but I honestly can't remember what I sounded like. But I stayed in accent for that, and I think I definitely annoyed quite a few people with that. But they sort of got used to it after a while. Yeah, for 7 months I wore a really bad accent, and my attempt at facial hair, which it was so cold, everyone had these amazing beards to keep them warm, and I had this really pathetic peach fuzz sort of gently kind of scattered around my face and a very bad accent. So it was a difficult time, but I got through it. But I'm sorry, I genuinely can't give you a sample of it because I can't remember what it sounded like, but not good.
Yeah. Then it's time to another question. Yeah, let's come down to the hand on the front row.
Oh, fizzy water just went straight up my nose, I'll be honest with you. Sorry, I'm ready for you though.
Thanks. Okay, this is a bit of a weird question, but do you personally, or like the cast, have any traditions that you follow after you complete a movie or when a movie releases?
Any traditions that I follow? Oh, I tend to get drunk with my family at premieres. That's a thing. Gosh, I'm trying to think. I always keep one set of sides, so like a little, and please forgive me if I'm patronizing you, I don't even know if that's a known terminology, but like, it's like a little extract of the script, and you get it each day with a bit of the schedule printed out on the front of it. So I keep sides from like significant days. So I've got sides from pretty much every film I've done, and at least one copy of the script. I did a film called The Little Stranger, which is a horror film, kind of. That's reductive, but it is sort of a horror film. And I've got a copy of that, and it's just, unexplainably, it's just got blood on the front of the page. And I kept it, but it's so creepy that every time I go past it in my house, I'm like, I might throw that out. That's really weird. So I keep things like that at the end of films. I always try and steal something, slash ask the prop department for something. So I've got little kind of things from different movies I've done. I've got a stick made that looks like a very, very real, quite hefty, more like a log, but that you could wield and like hit someone with, made of foam. And that was super fun to just charge at your friends with that, and then they realise it's foam, and then that was a great, that was good times. So that was off my first film, and yeah, I always tried to do that, but yeah, I don't know if there's sort of any traditions necessarily, but I'd keep little keepsakes, and I try to write down or keep a record of like really memorable things as well to like look back on. Yeah.
Then I think we've got time for two more questions, so let's jump to the hand back there first.
Hi. So you spoke a little bit about how like you've been taking on roles that bring about more like awareness for things that are happening socially, like in Detroit. And I wanted to know, do you feel like you have an obligation to do that because of your status as like a public figure? And do you feel like other actors should have that obligation as well to educate people on and like be socially aware?
Mm. Yeah, I think partly because of, you know, it kind of, in sense, we're coming to terms with my own privilege as well, you know? So yes, I feel like it's my obligation. I feel like when invited, you know, by the people who might not experience the same level of privilege to tell those stories with them, then I'm willing and hoping to accept that like invitation. But it's not, you've got to be careful not to be sort of telling other people's stories for them as well, you know? So I want to be wary of that too. And sorry, what was the second part of your question? Because I just completely
blanked. Do you feel that other actors have the obligation to do that?
Right. It's kind of not for me to say, but I think generally speaking, yes, I feel like that is, for me, always the way I've seen the role of the actor is to kind of make sure that what you're putting out in the world is, you know, is something that you is something that you can be assured will have a positive impact on people, or else why are you doing it? It's kind of really scary to think about the fact that like you're just putting it out there because you hope people think you're good at it. It's like that just seems like you're not maximizing your own potential or really kind of serving the medium or the people who ultimately keep you employed as well. Like it's not a respectful way to go about your business, I think too. So yeah, I think so. I'm still working it out, you know, and got a lot of educating to do. So myself, that was, by the way. I still need to like educate myself on a lot of things. It's a kind of learning process, and I'm far from at the end of it.
I think we've got time for one final question. So yeah, let's go to the hand on the right just behind.
I'm just wondering, is there a film or TV program that sort of moved you or stuck with you in any way?
Like recently, just in general. Well, the reason I mentioned Good Will Hunting is because I think I found watching particularly the conversations between Will, Matt Damon's character, and Robin Williams' character as his sort of therapist, I found watching two men being emotionally like vulnerable with each other and talking about mental health really refreshing, because I think I have naturally taken on some quite kind of like toxic expectations of masculinity, which are that, you know, men don't cry and they don't share their emotions, and in many ways we don't do things that we vilify women for doing, and we should, you know, I think follow in women's lead as far as being more emotionally intelligent and being, I think, better communicators. And it's obviously a sad fact that, you know, lots of those pressures that men have in many ways placed on themselves lead to such kind of tragic circumstances amongst men in particular. So yeah, that film has always stuck with me, I think for that reason, just watching men be emotionally vulnerable with each other and talk openly and honestly and from the heart, and you know, progress and develop so positively through those conversations and experiences. And I've always loved that film for that reason. So yeah, that's that's probably the one. But there's so much great stuff out there. And then in scenarios like this, I get asked and it all flies out of my head. But yeah, Good Will Hunting's definitely up there for that reason.
Well, what a note to end on. So unfortunately, that is what we've got time for. So ladies and gentlemen, please do join with me in thanking Will Poulter.
Thanks so much. Thank you very much. Thank you.